Spirit.
Amen.
You may be seated. So, children, did you get to see some fireworks? I looked outside and I sat on the deck last night and saw a few fireworks going off from around the neighborhood and in Delavan too, so I happened to see some. You know, there are years when I spend the entire worship service dealing with our nation and prayers for our nation and our concerns for our nation. And, well, that's all good and right on a 4th of July weekend. But this time around, I'm only going to address you children concerning that. And then we'll deal with other things in our main sermon for today. You know, it's about 245 years ago that this great nation that we live in was formed, and we get to share all of the freedoms we have just due to the forming of this great nation. Those worship things, all of the blessings we have are terrific freedoms that the Lord gives us. For instance, our nation allows us to actually speak against the president or Congress if we choose to do so. You know that there are countries where if you did that, you might have your tongue removed or you might be put to death. And then, of course, there's the freedom that we Americans can have guns if we choose to have guns to hunt with and protect ourselves or others. And I really believe there's been a few people along the way that have probably thought twice about overtaking our nation when they realize that there's an awful lot of guns in a lot of the homes in the whole country. But of course, of all the freedoms that we have, the most wonderful freedom we have is that we can worship our Lord and Savior Jesus. We are free to tell people about Jesus. And you know, there are countries where if you told somebody about Jesus, you'd be put in prison or death too. Not so here. We have the wonderful thing of being able to rejoice in the freedom of telling people that Jesus died not only for your sins and mine, but for the sins of the whole world. So that's why we rejoice and we celebrate with fireworks. It's a wondrous thing we have that we can actually celebrate the freedoms that we have in this country of ours. So thank God for those freedoms and continue to praise God and pray to God that He'll continue to keep us also in His care. Now, here the gospel lesson for this Sunday recorded in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 10. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master, Jesus says. It is enough for students to be like their teachers and servants like their masters. If the head of the house has been called Beelzebub, how much more the members of his household? So do not be afraid of them, your enemies, for there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Whoever acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before him, before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before others, I will disown before my Father in heaven. pray. O Lord our God, govern the nations on earth and direct the affairs of this world so that your church may worship you in peace and joy. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
And here are the two readings that I have chosen for our text for today, recorded in Luke chapter 1 and Matthew chapter 1. How will this be, Mary asked the angel, since I am a virgin? The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. May your word be fulfilled. Then the angel left her. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. This is the word of God. So, Pastor, where in the world are you going to go with this one? After all, we all know about the Apostles' Creed and we know about Jesus. So how in the world are you going to deal with anything here? And especially, isn't it rather obvious that he was born of the Virgin Mary? That he was conceived, obviously, because he couldn't have been born otherwise. Well, my friends in Christ, please remember that none of the articles of the Apostles' Creed, none of the things brought up there were brought up except that someone in history denied it or disputed facts. And so for that reason, it's very important for us to take a good look at why Creed especially makes the point that he was conceived and also born. And so we've learned with Martin Luther to say, I believe that Jesus Christ, begotten of the Father from eternity and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord. And so we confess, I believe in Jesus, conceived and born. Well, after 41 years in the ministry, I can finally say I've come full circle and I can give you Christmas in July. How about that? Well, fact is that we aren't going to spend a whole lot of time dealing with the event of Jesus' birth. We spend a lot of time about that during Christmas each year. The only thing is, we say it in December, so we all assume that it was on a midnight clear back way back in those days, in December, that Jesus was born on a cold winter's night. Well, there's no proof at all that he was born in December. In fact, it might have been July, for all we know. But celebrated. And you know, I have to admit that there was no contention in the fact that Jesus was born. There was no contention about that he was conceived, obviously. But the real point is that he was conceived by the Holy Spirit. There's the difference. Many years ago now, I was teaching a young group of middle school students in catechism lessons. And as I was teaching them, we were dealing with the Virgin Mary, which I also had mentioned. And all of a sudden, this one young man said, oh, Pastor, did you say Virgin Mary?
impossible.
Yes. And the point? All those years he had memorized his parts for Christmas Eve services. He had recited Bible passages. He had recited Bible passages in catechism classes dealing with the Virgin Mary. But it suddenly hit him. This is impossible. And I said, yes, it is. But with God, all things are possible, including this. It was very reasonable for him, now that he had reached the age of reason, that he would ask that question. In fact, I would say that would be a question that we would all ask at one time in our life, once we come to realize it. After all, we're not alone in that. You know, the Virgin Mary also asked the question, how can this be, since I'm a virgin? And Gabriel told her that the Holy Spirit would come upon her, and she would conceive and give birth to the Son. She realized that it was an impossibility in and of ourselves. Nobody can be a virgin and then give birth to a child unless that should be God's decision, and it was in this case. And of course, her fiancé Joseph was troubled by the whole idea too. He wondered what he should do in such a case. He knew he had not had any sexual relations with her, so how in the world could she be pregnant now? And this whole lame idea that somehow God was having her pregnant? Come on now, this never happened before in history. Why would it suddenly happen now? So, being the good man that he was going to take care of the whole situation nice and quietly. He was just going to send her away privately. He could have had her tried for sexual immorality and technically could have even had her stoned to death. But instead, an angel also came to him in a dream and assured him, Mary's telling you the truth. This child really is God's own son. Give him the name Jesus because he'll save his people from their sins. And of course, the angel also said at that time, these words, the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. It was the fulfillment of the prophecy by Isaiah. So, God was coming to live with us all for a while. And he had chosen Mary specifically as the one through whom he would come into this world. And he had chosen Joseph as his stepfather to make sure that he would be raised properly and loved properly by father and mother alike. What was considered the impossible was now done. Well, when you and I think about that, it can be rather difficult for us too, can't it? After all, science tells us that this is an impossibility. But the Bible speaks concerning that. It says, Jesus said, let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you, anyone who does not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. You know, sometimes people get confused about this one and say, oh, well, unless you become a Christian as a little child, you can never become a Christian at all. That isn't what it says there. Jesus said, if you don't receive the kingdom of God like a little child does. Well, how does a little child receive the kingdom compared to what you or I as adults might do. Well, just talk to a little child once and you'll find out. Tell the child about our triune God, that the Lord is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but one God. And the child will say, yes, okay, what else? And if you say the same thing to an adult, they'll say, 3 equals 1? That's not good math. That doesn't make sense. How can this be? The Bible tells us, Jesus tells us, to receive the kingdom of God like a little child. Not as a little child, but like a little child. Yes, it can be that you and I receive the kingdom already as little children. That's possible, but nevertheless, we all need to keep our childlike faith, which says, okay, if it's in the Bible, then it's truly so. When we speak God's word, then we'll say, all right, Lord, even if I don't understand it fully, or I can't comprehend this, I will believe it because you have said so. We'll be like Mary. I am the Lord's servant. May your word to me be fulfilled. No doubt, no lack of faith, simply believing, accepting with childlike faith what God is going to do for her and through her, and also what God will do for us or through us. So, even though we're in this modern world of ours, we recognize that we need to believe it, even if there are many, many, many who refuse to accept anything that they can't prove themselves from their own reason. In fact, even to the point of denying that the Bible is God's word and questioning that. But rather, we would say, we'll trust the Bible. So, we not only believe and declare in the creed that Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit, but then we also declare born of the Virgin Mary. You know, that was not only foretold by Old Testament prophets and by the angels, but God fulfilled it, what he promised in Christ. If you've got a copy of one of the earlier translations of the scriptures, back from the 1950s, one of the earlier English translations, a Revised Standard Version. The Revised Standard Version makes a very big point, and there's been any number of theologians that have made the big point, that Alma, the word for that is translated virgin, really can mean a young woman who has not yet had children. Well, that's a little different from virgin, necessarily. So what's right? You know, it doesn't really matter. Because whether or not the word in the Old Testament means that, when it's used in the New Testament, it's used in the context of Mary and Joseph both denying the possibility that a virgin can conceive, and yet that's exactly what was going to take place. And the Lord, through the angel, points to that passage from Isaiah as proof that the virgin was going to conceive and give birth to a child, a son. So, we don't really need to be too concerned about that, do we? Out of all the women of all time, God chose Mary to be the one who would give birth to his own son. And so we could say of Mary that she is the mother of our Lord, most blessed of all women for that reason. a important question for us, however, concerning the fact that Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. The question is why? Why did he have to be? Why couldn't he just be born of two normal human beings? To be perfect God and perfect man, to be our Savior. When he came to this earth, he came as the child of Mary and the Holy Spirit. Why is that important? Well, look what he himself said. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. Sinful human beings give birth to sinful human beings. That's a simple rule that is always true. David said, he was sinful from the time my mother conceived me. And so from conception on. And then we have the words of Paul in Romans 5. Just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people, because all sinned. When Adam and Eve fell into sin, they not only brought sin into the world for themselves, but for every one of their descendants after them, because each and every one would be born of two sinful human beings. And so it would be. Well, if that's the case, and it certainly is, you see how important it would be for Jesus not to be born of two sinful human beings? If that were the case, he would be born sinful. He would be conceived sinful. And could not possibly bear the sins of the whole world on himself. But he wasn't. He was born of one sinful human being and of the Holy Spirit. Oh, I know, I know. I'm touching a nerve with that comment. Because there are those that contend that Mary was also sinless. But if Mary was sinless, why did she sing in the Magnificat, "My soul glorifies the Lord and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior"? If she wasn't a sinful human being, she wouldn't have needed a Savior from sin. But she's the one who sang that, confessing the fact she also needed a Savior and that she rejoiced in that Savior. Well, now then, a moment ago I told you about Romans chapter 5, you know? Just as sin entered the world through one man and death through sin, so it passed to all people. That was concerning Adam, our first forefather. Paul, in the same context, says, consequently, just as one trespass resulted in condemnation for all people, so also one righteous act resulted in justification, declaring not guilty and life for all people. For just as through the disobedience of the one man, and that would be Adam, the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man, Jesus, the many will be made righteous. God chose the second Adam, Jesus, to live perfectly for us so that the first Adam's sin would be wiped out, forgiven, in you and me and everyone else, specifically declared for all people, that all who believe in him will be saved. So Jesus died for your sins that would have condemned you, and my sins that would have condemned me, and not only for our sins, but for the sins of the whole world. Those who cast aside the virgin birth basically cast aside a perfect man and a perfect God that could pay for your sins and mine. The only one that could pay for your sins and mine. So it is extremely important that we realize how it is that Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, and is our Lord. And so we confess, I believe in Jesus Christ, our Lord, conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. May that truth stay with us day after day, year after year, until we see him face to face. Amen. And the peace of God which passes all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. And we go directly now to the responsive prayer. Gracious God and Father, we praise you for the countless blessings which we receive from your hand, the bounties of creation and the beauties of creation and the bounties of the earth, the joy of life and the pleasure of friendship, the good of work and the gift of rest, the privilege to share happiness and sorrow with one another. Above all, we praise and thank you for your saving word and for your Son's body and blood which you give us to eat and to drink in the sacrament. Through these means of grace, you send the Holy Spirit into our hearts and unite us to Jesus and to the whole Christian church on earth.
Strengthen us with this heavenly food. Increase our trust in Christ and our love for one another.
Great God and Lord, without your continuing help, we easily waver in our faith, lose courage, and grow careless in our watchfulness. The times and days are perilous. Give us strength to face the evils of each day with fresh confidence. Open our lips to speak of your grace, and move us to use the gift that you give us to share your word of salvation with all people. Protect and prosper the family, the school, and all good institutions that you have established for the benefit of society. On this weekend, we especially pray for our government. In these days of trouble, we especially need it to remain strong so that it will protect and keep us all. Be with all our leaders so that they guide us in the best possible way to maintain our democratic republic and the freedoms we have due to our U.S. Constitution and amendments. Remember in mercy those who are sick and suffering, and bring your healing to troubled homes and lives.
Move us to pray for those in need and to help them with deeds of kindness.
Hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Now, eternal God and Father, keep us in the saving faith, and so enable us to overcome all things through our Lord Jesus Christ. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Christian friends, gathered in the name of the one who created all things and unites us to Christ through our baptism, we prepare to receive God's good gifts. With confidence, let us draw near to God, confess our sin, and be renewed in God's mercy and grace. For our failure to be attentive to the care of your creation, Father, forgive us. For our neglect of ourselves in body, soul, and spirit, Father, forgive us. For our lack of care for the poor and the unloved, confidently in your love.
Lord Jesus, forgive us.
For our sins of selfishness and our sins known and unknown,
Holy Spirit, forgive us.
For our failure to recognize the gifts given and supported in your power,
Holy Spirit, forgive us.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, God's love is shown to us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since you have called me by Christ's authority, I announce to you all that you are forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. In the water of baptism, you were joined with Christ and made a child of God. Anointed with the Holy Spirit, you are free to live as God's people sent to serve the world.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. When he'd given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
We will now continue with, "May this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in the true faith unto life everlasting. Go in peace." We pray. Hear the prayer of your people, O Lord, that the lips which have praised you here may glorify you in the world, that the eyes which have seen the coming of your Son may long for his coming again, and that all who have received in his true body and blood the pledge of your forgiveness may be restored to live a new and holy life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Once again, God's blessings to you all. And good rest of the 4th of July weekend. And God's blessing till we see each other again.